welcome each of you, friends and guests and family. I invite you to sign the attendance pads and pass them along the pews. As we gather in worship, what announcements do you wish to share? Remind you that next week is communion. I will be away in Ohio for a continuing ed event. Mary Anna Reinhart will be our guest preacher, and she will also be leading communion. On behalf of Nancy McCallion, if you had expressed interest in purchasing a t-shirt, she needs to know what color you want and what style. There is an email that was sent out. If you need more information, see me after worship. If there are no other announcements, please rise as you are able for the call of worship.
The psalmist asks, O Lord, who may abide in your tent? Who may dwell on your holy hill? The response is, those who walk blamelessly and do what is right, and speak the truth from their heart. Those who honor the Lord, stand by their promises, and who do not take bribes. These are the ones who stand firm in faith and will not be moved. As we gather in worship, we look for strength of our foundations of faith, even as we keep reaching for new understandings as the Spirit moves among us. Come, let us worship fullness of your heart, of our hearts, and our lives, listening to the faith of our ancestors, and paying attention to how God calls us to live bold and courageous lives now.
Thank you. And showed up Caesar and Herod, who knew nothing about the Bible. But then there were also some really thought-provoking ones towards the end of kids coming forth and talking about times when people just looked away instead of coming to help. Whether it was being bullied or abused or homelessness or struggling with depression. And one of the girls in my small groups shared that that really hit home for her, that that was the way she wanted to be strong and courageous when she went back home, of making a point of not looking away when she saw somebody struggling or alone or just different, and of instead of looking away, actually trying to seek those people out, trying to see them, the people who try not to be seen. The students led the scriptures, times of scripture and litanies, and you'll see on our video, Eliana and Kara were part of that too, so you'll see them up on stage reading. And then of course there were the speakers, five different dynamic speakers, brother and sister duo on Sunday morning. Eliana's favorite was Chris Laudrum on Saturday night, and he did his sermon, he tied in Legos, so you'll see a picture of him in the video with a Lego cross. And he talked about not feeling like we can't serve or we can't be called or used by God because we're broken. And the quote that Eliana and I keep going back to, he says, tacos break all the time and we still love them. And I just thought that was a really great image. But I just keep on reminding myself that God uses us even in our imperfection. And Michaela Alphonse on Saturday morning talked with us about Mary, and Eliana and Kara and even a lot of the other adults I talked to, she really helped us look at Mary's strength and courage in a new way. Even in the 21st century, the thought of getting pregnant when you're engaged to another man is a really scary thought, and there are enough things that we can think of that make that a terrifying situation. But Michaela pointed out to us that in Jewish law, what should have happened is she should have been dragged out of her house and stoned in front of her family. And so, it just puts a little different, that I always kind of picture Mary as obedient and submissive, and she was, but also thinking of what an amazing, radical act of courage that was for her to say to God, maybe it's, what you say. So, that was a powerful weekend, but probably Kara, Eliana, and I, probably our favorite part, came after the worship service on Saturday morning, and Kara's going to share that.
So on Saturday, we had the option of two different workshops to go to, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. But the one we went to in the morning really spoke to us. We went to one led by David Radcliffe, who talked to us about especially children who were working without getting paid enough. And that really spoke to us because it just showed us, wow, they should be getting paid more for what they do. And so we support them by buying this backpack from Burma, and this brings the troops somewhat for our country. But we were to support them by buying them. But he informed us that these two, because he went to visit these people, and he informed us that he spoke to a woman and a daughter who made a total of 75 cents a day together. Not each of them, together. And a chicken where they live costs $17. So it's like they have to save up for a very long time if they would buy a chicken. So that's really what's going to happen to us on Saturday.
So this is a picture of me and Kara with the band ADA, or A Day Awaits. This was a concert that we had on Saturday night. They're a Christian pop group, and a lot of music was really powerful because it held like meanings, it held a lot of scripture in it, and it was really powerful. Another great part was we got free glow sticks, and at the end we got to take a picture with the band so that they could post it, and then we got to take a picture so that we could post it or have it to bring back to our church. So it was just a really great time that we got to spend together in worship, but also getting close to the concert, which is great.
Video of images. Unfortunately, I guess it's not working to do it in worship here, but please do see it in the gathering area following worship.
In the beginning of Colossians, the author, likely Paul, declares that Christ is the image of God, the firstborn of the dead, the head of the church. Christ has reconciled all to God through his death on the cross. The author calls the people to keep their groundedness in Christ and be built up in faith. This may have been an early hymn in the church. Colossians 1, 15, 29, and 2, 6, 7. And I'm reading from the Common English Bible. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the one who is first over all creation. Because all things were created in him, both in the heavens and on the earth, the things that are visible and the things that are invisible, whether they are thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He existed before all things, and all things are held together in him. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the one who is firstborn among the dead, so that he might occupy the first place in everything. Because all the fullness of God was pleased to live in him, and he reconciled all things to himself through him, whether things on earth or in the heavens, he brought peace through the blood of his cross. Once you were alienated from God, and you were enemies with him in your minds, which was shunned by your evil actions, but now he is reconciled to you in his physical body through death, to present you before God as a people who are holy, faultless, and without blame. But you need to remain well established and rooted in faith, and should not shift away from the hope given in the good news that you heard. This message has been preached throughout all creation under heaven, and I, Paul, became a servant of this good news. Now I'm happy to be suffering with you. I'm completing what is missing from Christ's suffering through my own body. I'm doing this for the sake of his body, which is the church. I became a servant of the church by God's commission, which was given to me for you in order to become a servant, in order to complete God's work. I'm completing it with a secret plan has been hidden for all ages and generations, but which has now been revealed to this holy people. God wanted to make you glorious riches of his secret plan known among the Gentiles, which is Christ living in you, the hope of glory. This is what we preach, as we warn and teach every person with all wisdom, so that we might be present in each one mature in Christ. I work hard and struggle for this goal with energy, which works in me powerfully. So live in Christ Jesus the Lord in the same way you received him. Be rooted and built up in him, and be established in faith and overflow with thanksgiving just as you were taught.
It is a very dense text with a lot to unpack. In some ways, it's hard for a preacher to follow something that is, to use a high theological term, but very Christologically packed. The author has a very high view of who Christ was. So who am I to try to explain it? I came here to Ridgeway a little over 13 years ago. In that time, we as a congregation have experienced a lot together. Births, deaths, dedications and baptisms, celebrations, anointings, sorrows and grief. great joys. I personally have experienced changes. Family members have grown and, in the case of Jonah, have come into being. I've grown in ways that aren't visible, but maybe the most visible change I've seen from 13 years ago, when I look in a mirror, is an increase of gray hair. On Fridays during the school year, I volunteer for an hour in a kindergarten class. And one day, one of the very sweet little girls came up to me and said, "You have a lot of gray hair. Do you dye it that way?" And my response to her was what my grandmother used to say, "No, I've earned every one of them." Some dye their hair, either for change or to maintain a sense of youthfulness, and that's fine. I'm not inclined to do so, mostly because I don't want the work of maintenance. I don't want to worry about someone wondering if my roots are showing. The dreaded roots. It's funny though, because what we may wonder about with hair is an entirely different matter when it comes to faith. We, each of us, are bearers of a heritage that shapes who we are and what we are about in the world. In our lives, we strive to bear the image of Christ, to show that he is the head of our body of faith and the source of our actions. In Christ, we have peace, and so the scripture says, experience the fullness of God. The author of Colossians, maybe Paul, was trying to encourage the believers there to find strength in Jesus, whose life revealed a way of living different from the culture around them. The author talks of faith in big terms, phrases, the first of creation, all things in heaven and on earth, the firstborn from the dead, the fullness of God. These are not phrases of a God who is to be taken lightly, but a Savior who is worth risking one's life to follow. The believers who first heard these words needed a big faith to carry them through the challenges of life. It called them to believe in Jesus as an alternative to the powers and rulers of their time. The way of Jesus is different from the ways of the world that praise knowledge and self-accomplishment. In one commentary on Colossians, the author Jerry Sumney writes, "The church possesses an allegiance that supersedes the claims of empire. This alternative allegiance will require them to live in ways that people around them see as disruptive and perhaps subversive or even illegal." Knowing that, the author calls on believers to hold fast to a faith that is bigger than they are, and to believe with all their hearts that God is capable of giving hope beyond what they could find on their own. What gave hope to the early church is also what we need today. When we face realities that tell us that Christianity is something that we hold in a myriad of other parts of our lives, in a time when many equate Christian faith with just belonging to a church or holding certain political views, the words of Colossians call us to pattern our lives after Christ and no one or nothing else. Christian faith isn't about having membership rights and responsibilities, but about how we live as a community, trying to follow Jesus' teachings and example. It is in recognizing that through Jesus we experience a different way of living and a peace beyond our own that we begin to understand the fullness of the scripture that is so dense. In Jesus, we as Christians see God in the flesh. And everything else we experience in life is built on this foundation and this trust. We believe that in all the mysteries of the world, God is somehow at the center of them. And Jesus is our way of trying to navigate them and to find understanding, aware that we do not have all the answers. So being faithful should put us at odds with at least some of the cultural norms around us. That question, putting authority in anything that we can't see or grasp or earn on our own, being rooted in Christ gives us strength to stand up to criticism or challenge of what we believe. What we are called to be and do in this world. And so as people of faith, as followers of Christ, we look out not just for those who are on top, who have power, but also, maybe even more, for those who have little or nothing in this world. Watching out for the families that struggle making 75 cents a day when chickens cost $17, and saying it's not only not right that they aren't paid enough, but questioning why children have to work at all. Why children face challenges that are far beyond what any of them should hold in their years. Faith calls us to reach out, to remember that in God, we are connected. As a church here at Ridgeway, we have built on the faith of those who dreamt of forming a church in this part of Harrisburg. They, in turn, built on the faith of brethren who settled in this part of the country and state. Early brethren in Germany sought to follow Jesus as fully and faithfully as they could, even if it meant risking their reputation and in some cases their lives. More than 300 years later, we as a church are still trying to figure out how to remain rooted in this church and heritage. Annual conference sharing will take place a few weeks from now. But most of you have heard of the struggles the wider church has had in forming and following a compelling vision. Surely it's not in claiming specific theological positions. There is great diversity in the church, seen at both a junior high conference and at the annual gathering, of brethren who come together, who follow Jesus as fully and faithfully as they can. There are different understandings of how scripture is to be embraced and how those scriptures apply to our lives today. Believe if there is something compelling, not just for this little group known as the Church of the Brethren, but for Christianity as a whole, it is connected to our being grounded, rooted in Christ, a divide and a desire to follow Jesus in all that we do. This rootedness puts Jesus' words into action, above arguments we might have. And it gives us the hope to believe that beyond divisions, beyond disagreements, we can find peace in Him. When we get caught up in challenges, we do well to ask if our roots are showing. Are we living in a way that reveals the rich heritage that has been passed down to us? And as we work at revealing our roots, we remember that the purpose of roots is to draw water for the whole tree, for the whole plant. And that plants, trees, need leaves to continue to grow. We've heard from participants in the National Junior High Conference, and we look to leaders like these to keep reminding us to claim a living faith. Older generations give strength. Younger generations help us to continue to have a vision. In our roots, and in our current realities, and in whatever God is calling us to be, we seek to live as a people who trust in Christ to guide us, to give life to us, and in all that we do, may Christ be revealed in us and through us. Older or younger, somewhere in between, new or with more gray hairs than we can count, may our roots, our true, faithful, spiritual roots, reveal our heritage and our dreams, leading us to act courageously in Christ's name. May it be so.
Thank you.
God, and give us the resources we need to serve in your name. Bring fulfillment to those whose lives feel incomplete, inspiration to your prophets, and a sense of purpose to those who work day by day in tasks that seem poor. May our gifts and efforts share in your abundance.
Let us join together in prayer. Oh God, you are with us at all times. We are thankful for the blessings that you pour out into our lives, the gifts of life, of remembrance, of family, of this community. Thank you for support that reminds us of our rootedness. Thank you for the ways that we strengthen and sustain each other as we work together in faith. Thank you for inspiring us to serve in your name, to pay attention to the needs around us, to the concerns of friends and neighbors, to the concerns of the world. You call us to pay attention to those who are struggling and suffering, to care for the world itself, to care for all who are trying to find their way. Hold us. Continue to give us vision. Let us not be satisfied with knowing what has been, to trust in our own accomplishments. Remind us that all that we do is for you, and that you call us to continue to live, to serve, to share in your name. And as we do that, deepen our connections with one another, strengthen our hopes for peace, ground us in the realities around us, and give us vision for the world that is to be. All this we pray in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Serve as you are able, but do not be distracted in your service.